The last time I spoke out regarding a prominent local councillor, I had a visit from the police and was forced into being interviewed under caution. So believing the public have a right to see the evidence for themselves, I released this report in the public's interest and also put links below to the supported evidence for what follows. My name's Dave Humphrey. Between 2012 and 2018, I ran a campaign in Cambridgeshire that uncovered the abuse of approaching £1 million of public and private funding. Now, although I had no intention whatsoever of starting any new campaigns, unfortunately, whilst the fact issue was still running, I got dragged into another matter. Consequently, I now find myself in receipt of more evidence as to the public being denied the truth, though this time, rather than the public's money, I believe the abuse is regarding their democratic rights. Now, for months I've been asking myself, do I really need the inevitable attacks and possible intimidation that's going to come with simply being a messenger? Then I read an argument put forward by a psychologist who suggested that it is itself sometimes unethical to stay quiet. But due to what I feel experience also allows me to say is our district council's apparent strategy in dealing with such matters, I've simply decided to stop wasting my time formulating evidence complaints for the council to dismiss. Therefore, as my final act as a campaigner, I'm simply going to publish the evidence along with some of my conclusions to then basically let people decide for themselves what they want to do with that information. The £200,000 investigation into FAP, commissioned by the county council, validated nearly all of my claims. Simply because they were evidence-based. And the same applies here, as demonstrated by the links below. So let's get started with an example of the kind of online attacks this alleged Councillor Tierney has been inflicting on people for years. And one personal to myself, when my campaign got caught in a crossfire of what many feel is his long-term vendetta against another councillor. Firstly, he attempted to convince the public a case that exposed the abuse of nearly £1 million of funding was just a load of old tosh, and apparently consolidated this months later by categorising the case as gibberish. He then went on to accuse us of attacking the services for the elderly, disabled and vulnerable, followed by the insinuation these attacks were motivated through personal gain. As I believe everybody locally knows, I was attacking the many offences, criminal and fraudulent acts, and abuse of the public purse, not the services themselves. Something that cost me over 6 years of my life and tens of thousands in loss of time and earnings. So where was the personal gain exactly? Furthermore, as my family and my long-term friends know, years ago I walked away from a very highly paid business career. So hardly the time to now start attacking charitable organisations to line my own pockets. In fact, I now spend my Christmas days running a free taxi service to take the elderly and the vulnerable to a free Christmas dinner. Yet here I was simply trying to fight an injustice against people's livelihoods and the public purse, to then have this stranger and a councillor under a duty to protect the public's money attempted to discredit our efforts by plucking offensive allegations out of thin air. Anyway, now he'd apparently spun his unpleasant attack into existence, it would now appear what he wanted to achieve was to give it some form of official credibility. As can be seen here, Councillor Tierney informs the public how he sat in a council overview and scrutiny meeting and demands how he knows the committee pretty much unanimously said that they didn't agree there was a case of merit here. However, the truth, apparently confirmed by the minutes of the meeting itself, was how the chairman stated she was unsure if this is something for the panel to be looking at when the police are involved. So then it was unanimously decided the case had no merit, as with his nasty allegation, apparently pure and utter fiction. So, was this done with a deliberate intent to deceive the public? Well, this online post certainly appears to support such a view. As we can see, it seems Councillor Tierney himself agreed the case shouldn't be looked at due to the police investigation, not because it was unanimously decided the case had no merit. He then further claimed even a former ally, Councillor Buckner, didn't take the opportunity to say she agreed with the argument, when in fact the minutes meetings appear to expose she was clearly the one who raised the issue. In my personal opinion, his post was quite simply a disingenuous attack in which he first distastefully used the elderly, the disabled and the vulnerable as some form of weapon to incite ill feeling against a councillor he simply didn't like. I further believe he then attempted to strengthen this attack by deceiving the public with a first-hand but fraudulent account of council business, a clear breach of the council's code of conduct. Conduct, I also believe you will agree, is repeatedly confirmed as we move forward with this report. In addition, I feel the need to raise an issue that will also become increasingly relevant to this report. You see, when attacking what he refers to as the usual suspects, which he defines as opposition and generic haters of all sorts, Councillor Tierney seems to perfectly describe his own official behaviour. For example, here he demands, when you follow their tracks back and check, you will invariably see that what was said is not what they say was said. Is that not a precise and exact description of what you've just witnessed? But before we move on to part two, I first feel it appropriate to mention how Councillor Tierney has apparently claimed to some people that he offered his help to my campaign. Though the truth being, this offer only came in response to my confronting this type of attack and wasn't wanted, trusted, or asked for. Nevertheless, notwithstanding how he had previously assessed information that initiated a police investigation as a load of old tosh, he incredibly continued to expect us to believe this was a genuine offer, to then insist how he was forensic and logical when he examined something. So was I right to refuse him? Well, yes, I know I'm smiling. That's because I know what's coming. You see, in part two, we're going to take a look at how he used his forensic and logical examining skills on a conduct complaint I was asked to assist with. Now, rather than logical, I believe some of what you're about to witness is so irrational in nature, I feel it must be asked. If in the example we've examined so far, he did in fact lie to the public about council business to simply continue some personal vendetta, then we have to ask, how far will he actually go? And what else will he be prepared to lie to you and I about whilst operating in his official capacity? Though, before you rush off the feed your curiosities, please assist in giving this the transparency I believe it deserves, and give the share button a tap, a like would be appreciated, and please remember to subscribe for any further update. So until the next time, take care, stay safe, but most importantly, try not to let the buggers get you down. Bye-bye.